Why do we use the CAN bus? The first reason is it's low cost. It consists of just two wires, and the associated CAN controller is inexpensive to produce, meaning its manufacture isn't challenging. It connects multiple microcontrollers with just one pair of wires. Before CAN, guys, for one microcontroller to communicate with another, each one needed a unique connection to the other. So, depending on how many ECUs you were connecting to, there were separate wires going to each ECU. Can you imagine how the costs were? With CAN, we've simplified things. How so? Just the ears. CAN high and CAN low with a resistance of 100 duety ohms between them, and that's it. Now, you can connect as many electrical control units as you want to these two wires. The CAN bus is efficient. What does that mean? It means there are messages that interrupt other messages based on their priority, and there's filtration via the identifier. What does all of this mean? It means that node 1 sends a packet with a specific ID. This bus broadcasts, guys. So when I send a message, everyone gets the same message. Everyone will see the message I send. You then decide if your CAN controller accepts or declines the message. If it accepts, it returns an acknowledgement indicating that it's the owner of the message. If it declines, then it doesn't send any response. So when you're setting up a full system, what do you do? For example, node 2 tells you it accepts any ED from 0x1F to 0x1FF. Therefore, it accepts any I within this range. When you send 0x1321, node 2 will accept it, but node 3 will decline. Those who decline won't respond, and those who accept will send back an acknowledgement. You have a filtration feature. I can specify that each ECU in the car has its unique range of addresses. All the other ECUs will decline, and you're the only one to accept because I've programmed you to accept that range since it belongs to you. I can also specify when two nodes send messages simultaneously. For instance, if node 2 sent with an ID of 12, and node 1 sent the same message with an ID of 10, who would prevail? If both sent at the same time, the one with the lower identifier wins. If I want to prioritize important data, I'll assign it a lower ID. So, if it's sent alongside another message, I've ensured it has the lowest ID, meaning the least identifier gets the highest priority. The CAN is reliable. What does this mean? We have five mechanisms for detecting errors in the CAN protocol. It can perform bit monitoring, meaning it checks each transmitted bit to ensure it was sent correctly. There's bit stuffing. For instance, if I send six ones, it gets concerned. It then inserts a zero between the fifth and sixth bits. The receiver then removes this zero to read them together, ensuring they aren't continuously stuffed with a certain value. It has a frame check where it examines the frame containing the start of frame identifier data and CRC. If a specific part of the frame size changes is damaged, or if certain bits are supposed to be set to specific values and they differ, it identifies the frame as erroneous and raises an error. There's an acknowledgement check. What's established in the vehicle? There's a receiver, meaning you can have software in the car that you've written to send to an ID that no node is assigned. For instance, if you send ADD10, can you send this without having a node in the car with ID10? It will then search all and find none of them have filtration in the range of 10. Hence, they won't return an acknowledgement. So it checks that if no ACK comes, it sends you an ACK error. This means I sent an ED and no one owns this ED. Nobody received it. Nobody responded with an ACK. Then in the software, you can tell it you're aware and ignore. Or you can instruct it to send again, twice, thrice, or even four times. If it sends within the vehicle and doesn't get an ACK, It could mean a node in the vehicle is burnt or a wire is broken. Because certainly you sent to fixed ranges, and in the car, you've divided each one to its range. As for the CRC, which stands for cyclic redundancy check, just as there are checksums protecting items, and as there are even and odd parity, there's something called the cyclic redundancy check. It's a part of a calculation with a formula. We know the data and, based on it, produce its CRC. This is then sent with the data. On the receiving end, we compute the SCC for the received data and compile them. If we find the CRCCs differ, it means there's an issue with the received data. So why is the CAN reliable? Because it has five mechanisms to protect itself from any problem. The CAN is robust, which means it's strong. What does this imply? It suggests that it can resist electrical disturbances or withstand electromagnetic inductance. What does this mean? If you have noise entering the bus resists this noise. How? Let's see now. The CAN is flexible. What does that mean? Indeed, there's CAN high and CAN low, and it operates based on events. What does this entail? Most of those working with CAN, you'll even find them in the software components in AutoStar using the COM stack or something that is event-based. For instance, node 1 sends an ID equals 10. Node D2 will filter this range. And if it matches, it pushes it up, then it might find specific data and based on this data, replies with an ID containing other information. Let's assume, for example, that node 1 was connected to an air sensor. If the air sensor detects a change, node 1 sends an identifier equals 30 heading to the brake ECU. Everyone else will discard this message except for the brake system because it recognizes this range and accepts it. Based on that, it will take action. The action is to stop the car and send another identifier to the transmission, warning it to avoid high speeds because it will apply the brake. Something along those lines. There's no involvement of a clock component. And even without it, everything runs smoothly because it's just two wires, making it quite flexible. Also, there's no chip select or such terminology involved. They say that the CAN bus is specifically designed for automotive applications. In the automotive sector, AT utilize the CAN bus. However, in the medical field or any other sector, its usage rate is less than 20. What is ISO 100-1898? It describes the entire CAN protocol. This is to understand it from a protocol perspective, the bit timing involved, the quantum time, and how this applies to any circuit you need to purchase. Who was behind the creation of CAN? The initial CAN project commenced in 1983 and was developed by the company Bosch. In 1986, it was presented. By 1987, the first CAN controller chip was marketed. In 1991, the CAN 2.0 was released for any semiconductor company wishing to manufacture CAN. So the specification is as stated. Its data transmission rate reached up to 1 megabit per second. The earliest version they developed could achieve a speed of 125 kilobit per second. However, this utilized a standard identifier, meaning its ID concluded with 11 bit. Later on, Mercedes adopted the CAN in 1992. Following that, in 1993, the ISO 100-1898 related to CAN was introduced and it underwent expansion in 1995.